service today, which is a celebration of Christian Family Sunday, but our emphasis will be on Mother's Day, so congratulations to all people involved in motherhood or being a job. I've been asked to announce that there's a mini trail lobster lunch today starting at 1, and you might like to attend that. Also, if you're visiting, we hope you've been asked to sign your name in our guest book and in our mix. The service has 5 people from the choir giving stories from their relationship with their mothers, and they will announce the names as we go along. So, I'd like us to sing together, if you've got your bulletin there, the intro. Carolyn will get started.
Received word of the sinking of the HMS Hood by Bismarck. meaning her only brother was almost certainly dead. She carried on, finished her shift. You couldn't detect an accent, but her choice of words occasionally betrayed her, talking about the route of her car or taking a lift up to a flat. She didn't talk a lot and rarely raised her voice, but when she talked, I listened. She had many talents. Cooking was not one of them. She was rich, right? But she enjoyed gardening, birdwatching, nature, and reading. She was an art and CBC fan. And in retirement, she took up Chinese brush painting and belly dancing. She continued to enjoy travel, turning to Africa on her own in her 70s, and over the years, coming to visit me in Cyprus, Germany, and even Nunavut, despite her hatred of the cold. While on a church rower, she lived an exemplary lifestyle and was a quiet model of Christian virtues. She remained proud of her Welsh roots and loyal to flew the Welsh dragon every St. David's Day. My most sincere wish throughout my life has always been that I could be half the woman she was. Please join me in hymn 651, Guide Me, O Love, Rachel.
Did not make one unclean. Jesus told the crowd, it's what comes from within. instead of shunning and trying to avoid others, we read the miracle of Jesus and heaven where he actually touches lepers. Now let us read responsibly on this miracle from the Gospel according to Luke. It's found on the last page of your bulletin. Now on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When Jesus saw them, he said,
"Go show yourselves to the priest."
And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw that he was healed, came back, praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked,
"Where are all the Samaritans? Where are the other nine? Was no one asked what you turned to be the first God, such as the former?"
Then he said to them, in the original languages of the Bible, the word translated as leprosy is a generic non-scientific term that can refer to several different skin diseases, including what we call today, what's called in the Bible leprosy. The reasons for this translation we need for another discussion, but for over the past 150 years, leprosy has become known as Hansen's disease, as it's written in your bulletin. The causative agent of bacillus was first isolated by a Norwegian researcher physician, Dr. Hansen, in 1869. The World Health Organization includes leprosy among the 22 tropical conditions called neglected. The latest report on leprosy by this organization, published in 2019, notes that leprosy still occurs in more than 120 countries and that there are more than 200,000 new cases each year. The number of annual new cases can be compared to 1 in 5 Nova Scotians. Although Hansen's disease is infectious, exactly how it is transmitted is not known for sure. We do know if left untreated, leprosy causes more physical deformity than any other infectious disease. Hansen's disease is known to occur at all ages. It used to be associated with poverty, but starting in the 11th century, during the Crusade period, the perception started to change when the disease was found to affect famous knights and rulers, including the King of Israel, or sorry, the King of Jerusalem. Open the fourth. There is good news. For more than 30 years now, a drug combination has been found to effectively cure Hansen's disease. Early treatment averts most disabilities. And anti-leprosy medicines are available free of charge in even the remotest parts of the world, according to the World Health Organization. We are grateful that the common grace God gives to all people made some people curious enough about this disease to identify it. Subsequently, God's grace motivated others to work diligently, to make further discoveries, and to find a treatment, and then to make that treatment available. The not so good news is that medical treatment is not enough. Medicine does not prevent, nor treat, the social and psychological aspects of the disease. People are still hesitant to seek treatment. In turn, this hesitancy puts people at risk of disabilities, and untreated persons contribute to ongoing transmission of the disease. The goal is to achieve a world free of leprosy and the causes and the problem it causes. The World Health Organization requests that we unite with others to raise our own awareness of Hansen's disease and spread that awareness concerning the facts, the curability, and the importance of early detection and treatment. That we act to eliminate stigma and discrimination based on health status. And finally, that we practice and promote treatment of all with compassion and respect. Together, we can accelerate the progress for the leprosy world.
I've been drawing for a long time now. I'm always getting the busy tone.
God's got a lot of stuff on his mind these days. Well, hold just a second.
Here's a message coming in, and God says, can you send this message to Manoli? Oh, there. Manoli, there's a message for you. Would you like to listen? Can you hear the message coming?
I can hear a voice.
Okay, that's good enough. God says, a message for Manoli. Manoli, Jesus loves you.
God says Jesus loves me. That's okay. Good. That's good.
God sends messages in different ways. You just have to listen.
Thank you. remember Mother's Day when my brother and I were under 10 and we prepared a breakfast of Rice Krispies with bananas for Mom. The image of us at the breakfast table with our parents that sunny Sunday morning, feasting our eyes on the glistening sparkles of sweet La Carver Lake, is timeless to me. In 1996, our new hymnbook was published, and to my joy, included the picturesque hymn, Jesus, You Have Come to a Lakeshore. This hymn brings up so many images of home, La Carver, the lakeshore, Mom. When we sing it, the words in verse 3, You need my hands, fully carrying through my labors to give others rest, and constant love that keeps on loving, spells Mom to me. Her gift of a full, long life, well lived from 1929 to 2021, touched many generations of folks. As the eldest of six, I had lots of time to spend with her. I enjoy hearing stories of the way her older brother, a musician, forced singing and band lessons on her and her siblings. The effects of the Depression and World War II on her family, and at the Depression, the death of her dad when she was only 14, the death of her oldest brother at the post of Italy in the war. Eventually, her family was uprooted from Antigonish and spent the latter part of her teens living in Fraser's Mills of the first century, which her uncle ran. After the war, they moved to the property next to Dad's in La Carver. It was here that she became a CJRT leader. She got married, developed a committed and busy life dedicated to family, church, and community. Mom always found time to prioritize fun in life. No matter what had to be done, she took time to read stories, spend hours with us at the lakeshore and on the lake in both summer and winter, as well as ensuring we had swimming lessons, 4-H, Sunday school, explorers, CGIT, youth group, choir, birthday parties, etc. Dad had lots for us to do in the farm and in forestry, yet Mom was the one that made the call for fun and diversity in life. She was a passionate caregiver. That was a role she inherited when Grandpa died. Dad had a sister with cerebral palsy, and Auntie was crippled, and Grandma developed Alzheimer's shortly after. When we joined them from our peaceful point cottage, the farmhouse continued as a hub of a very expanded family. Even two more babies were added. Along through our archives, photos, details of life for Mom filled with multi-generational family events, plus community and church activities and celebrations. We loved when Mom hosted UCW. In spite of that, to help with preparation and cleaning, the family reward of leftover sweets and the trimmed crusts of the sandwiches were filled to the edge as a treat. I'm sure there are many times when life became a blur for her during those busy years, yet it fills me with pride to dig through her treasures and remember that she became a lifetime member of UCW and was recognized for her dedicated service to church and community. When her health declined in later years, we had the pleasure of living, of having Mom live with us. So many evenings we retreat to the piano where she poured to the songs and hymns that meant so much to her. Together, we would deepen our understanding of each other's values and needs. The times when family and friends were joining us proved to be an extra special day of bringing us together and strengthening our ties, just as is in the hymn, Blessed Be the Tie That Binds. Mom spent the last couple of years of her life at PRK. COVID cramped busy, and she was deprived of family time for the first time in her life. When finally I could be with her again, she would be comforted by watching St. James online worship services and by singing a few hymns. So many times I listened to her sing, Jesus Loves Me, as she rocked her children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren to comfort them during needy times. During her final days, she asked me to sing that hymn to her. Retrospectively, I believe it comforted her as she knew she was on her way. And it has the line, Jesus loves me still today, walking with me on my way. So it is the legacy of learning and enjoying hymns as a tool to strengthen family ties, to share common experiences across the generations, to connect with each other and with God in a meaningful way, and to support our spirituality that is one of the most precious gifts that my mother gave to me. And now we will sing together again, 563.
Thank you.
expected to eat everything that was served at the table, but one of the vegetables that I absolutely detested was parsnip that had been fried. So there's that brown strip down the side that caramelized. And one of the techniques we sort of devised at the table was a little spider and parsnip in your pocket. The other vegetable that didn't go down too well at the time was squash, and I went out to the kitchen if I thought it was coming, going to be served, and not too much squash. You know, the squash is a little harder to hide in your pocket. That we sort of need a whole infestation of spiders in the same. Anyway, there was a dessert one that evening, and my mom was making meals. And this guy showed up for dessert, and down, of course, like typical pie, and a nice hole in the ground, and nobody said very much, but that looked to me like it was going to be pumpkin pie for dessert. So I served pieces, and I ate one down, it was pretty good. And she said, "Well, would you like another piece?" Pie. And I'm sure. And plates in the back of the second piece. She says, "It's squash." the whole new section of my brain opened up. Let's sing the hymn that Andrew has chosen. 173, "The Hymn is the Glory," please.
Thank you.
give us guidance and freedom to grow in experience and wisdom. On this day, we give thanks for those in our lives who have been like mothers to us, some related by blood, some come into our lives through happenstance, some have been part of our lives for decades, and others are new to us. These kind souls have nurtured, taught, comforted, challenged, and encouraged us. Without them, we wouldn't be who we are. We also remember those for whom Mother's Day is difficult. We pray that your love and compassion will bring them peace. This we pray in your name, joining together to say the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power of the world, forever and ever. Amen.
Full well. Mother's Day.
A time to mark that each of us is indeed fearfully and wonderfully made. Our mothers have helped us to know that we each are unique and special. When I agreed to share about my mother Betsy, it seemed natural, and she's still so alive in my heart. But why is that? I'm now older than she was when she passed away. My hunch is that beside being a loving mother, she had, by her own strength, by her own example, by her own actions, led me to my faith and my trust in God. I'm not talking only about Sunday school and church services, though I had both. I'm talking about how she faced adversity. I'm talking about seeing my own mother grow before my eyes. My parents were, by their own admission, like children when we were young in the 1940s in Marstown, New Jersey, USA. Four children in 5 years. Alcoholism had unstrung them for those years. Even though I was too young to understand it all, I saw parents who were not in control. But I also saw, with those same eyes, that through the grace of God, they changed and built their lives back. What an impression on my young self to see what can happen and how second chances can make a big difference. This gift from my childhood showed me the human dimensions as well as the scope and depth of God's love. My mother and my father were not perfect, but they wanted a healthy life and family. Their wonderful friend, Reverend John Van Dyke, led them. We became churchgoers. My sister, my best friend, and I went to a youth group led by the minister and his wife. My mother joined AA and eventually became a sponsor and then a counselor. My sibs and I grew up familiar with coffee clutches in our kitchen, where cigarette smoke and coffee smells filled the space, and with lots of laughter. This was definitely a comfortable place for these people, one of them who was nicknamed Bubbles. My mother grew in other ways, too. She was endlessly creative. The nursery school she founded in our home was famous for scarf dances and alligator music played on the piano. Each spring, she launched the littlest show on earth. It was a time of wonder as these youngsters brought their tiny treasures that were on display for each other and their parents. When my two brothers and my sister and I graduated from college, my mother announced that it was now her turn. She'd never had higher learning, even though she worked hard to ensure that we all had the chance. At 50 years, she enrolled in a nearby community college. Her fellow students saw her as an honorary grandmother. I'm sure they were as surprised as her phys ed teacher when she chose as her class project to do an interpretive dance to Bach's Air to a G-string. I saw her as an example in her final illness when she chose to die at home in hospice care. My sister and I were with her throughout. Her humor never left her as she called out, "Where are my glasses?" We said, "You don't need them, do you?" "Yes," she replied. So we located them. "Good," she said. "I've got my glasses and my bags packed. I'm in the front row and ready to go." Such a real woman, and I'm so grateful God gave her and her rich life to me. So we will now sing, "We Are Pilgrims on a Journey," hymn 595.
talk today is needed through down your gauntlet. So here's a glove, and if you lived in the Middle Ages and you took steel or pieces of iron and covered it all up, it would be a gauntlet, and it would be part of your arm that was defending yourself from sword cuts, etc. So anyway, that's where the gauntlet comes from. And if you were a knight in those ages, days, if somebody else bothered you, if you had a bone to pick with them, you would take your gauntlet and throw it down at their feet, and then they'd have to respond to your challenge. So that's the setup for the story. My mother's name is Enid, and it comes from the Welsh, and refers to spirit, life, and purity. So, one morning, 5 years old, in the kitchen, breakfast is over, Mama's coming up, and I decided to say the word. Four letters. Could be a noun or a verb. And if you play Scrabble with your grandmother, do not use it. So, here we are. I heard this voice, Frederick, and I knew from previous experience, Enid, Miss Purity herself, was on the warpath. So the room filled with tension, and we were waiting there. She said, Frederick, if you say that word again, and I don't care if it's a verb or a noun, actually she didn't say that very well. Frederick, if you say that word again, I'm going to wash out your mouth with soap. So here we are. Frederick, what are you going to do? Are you going to let God take over and deal with this? Is it going to be like the Lord's Prayer? Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Or are you going to exercise your newfound belief in free will? Will it be, I am the master of my fate? I am the captain of my soul. So how am I going to decide? Flip the coin. Heads, I go ahead and I say the word again. Tails, and I say I'm sorry about them, and you know, just disappear. So here we are. The coin's up there, and I can see and sense that some of you people are already chanting in your minds. Heads, 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 heads. So coin came down, come on here, looked at it, heads, yeah, you know. What about free will, Fred? You don't have to accept this. You can just turn the coin over and nobody's going to know. So I turned it over. And God was being a little funny that day. He gave me a coin with heads on both sides. So I said the word again. Well, 2 steps, and she was beside me. We had a small kitchen. And I never did figure out where she learned how to make use of the wrestling hold, the half Nelson. But she knew instinctively that if she used the full Nelson, she wouldn't have a hand free for the soap. So she grabbed me, and the soap came up, and well, this is like in the Bible, one third of a biblical experience. No, I wasn't cast into utter darkness. No, there was no weeping, but there was a lot of gnashing of teeth. And sitting, well, I had sinned. And I had received my due punishment. The command that I had broken when I sinned was the one that says, honor your mother and your father. And you know, when you, although it's not said specifically in the Bible, that when you break a commandment, you are going to receive divine retribution. Well, I think they throw the divine into this Me Too a bit, because in the end, the retribution was not divine, but divine. So, here we are. That's the end of my story, but tough love lasts a long time, and that's what it was. And the ultimate tough love that we know of is God and Jesus. Let's sing our closing hymn, and it's 262, The Mighty Fortress Is Our God.
Let's do the Carolyn Curry benediction together.